Okay, welcome back. So in the previous lectures, we have completed our survey of the properties of quantum mechanics from a very broad perspective of just setting up the theory. In this lecture, what we are going to do is to tackle a quite different problem. And somehow this is supposed to be closing for this week. We're gonna close the first modules of the course. The problem that I'm confronting you with is now on the complete opposite extreme from the one that we discussed in the last lectures. While the last lectures were very general, we were interested in very fundamental and abstract mathematical setup of the theory. Here, I'd like to ask a very practical question. So how do we solve quantum mechanics? Quantum mechanical problem. So, or to be more specific, actually, how do we solve the Schrödinger equation? The stationary Schrödinger equation. Now, of course, I have, computers can be of great use to solve this problem. However, even using computers, you can achieve an arbitrarily accurate solution of this problem only for a limited number of systems, particularly simple systems. We provided an example of some of these problems that you can solve exactly during the application to the numerical solution of the one-dimensional Schrödinger equation. Well, in that case, that was an exact solution. By exact, I mean that by appropriate, using reasonable resources, a desktop computer, and by appropriate number of, meshing points, you could approximate your wave function to any desired accuracy, up to rounding error, in principle. Now, as soon as the problem will become more complicated, and we will tackle this generalization to more complex problems in the second part of the course, as soon as the problem becomes more complicated, even relying on computer, even relying on supercomputers, actually, it is in many cases impossible to formulate the algorithms that provide an exact solution. And so, we have two options. Either we give up or we construct models for the solution. Or in other words, we devise approximation methods. Okay. So what can be conceived as an approximation? By approximation method in this case, I will consider, there are many approximation methods in the literature, and I would, I'm gonna divide them in two classes. Ideal and non-ideal. Now, this is not a common terminology in the literature. It's one that I'm just using here to get a message conveyed. By ideal approximation, I mean methods that can become exact by tuning parameters. Meaning, or, you know, by enlarging, for instance, the number of mesh points, or in other ways that we shall discuss, okay? And there are methods which are not ideal, which involve really hardcore approximation that even with infinite computer power, they'll never become exact. They always remain approximate. So why should we ever bother about talking about non-ideal methods? Well, because sometimes they are the only ones that can be afforded computationally. And in fact, I would say 99.9% of computational biochemistry is based on methods that are non-ideal. Density functional theory is one, which is by far the most commonly adopted methods for solving electronic structure problems in macromolecules. But also the Hartree-Fock methods that we will discuss in this course follows under the category of non-ideal. And basically they are non-ideal because in addition to the Schrödinger equation, you're forced to making bold additional assumptions, which are not motivated by, say, mathematical concepts or they're motivated heuristically or in the best possible case on physics ground. So you use physical intuition to sort of devise additional assumptions that simplify the problem. And we'll come to that many times. But I just want to make one point that, you know, whenever, especially people coming from a very rigorous training, such as mathematicians and sometimes computer scientists and theoretical physicists, they don't feel quite at ease, quite comfortable with introducing physical assumptions into the solution of a mathematical problem such as the Schrödinger problem. However, in many cases, this is so because they do not appreciate that physics is all about assumptions. Some people say physics is the art of finding the good assumption and the good approximation, because the problems that you can really solve without making any assumption are typically a handful and they are totally irrelevant for nature. So let me give an example. We did find an exact solution of the Schrödinger equation for the one-dimensional harmonic oscillations ground state. And I told you that with a little bit more work, you can get the entire spectrum of eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. That's fantastic. That's an example of an exact solution. But are there physical systems that can be exactly modeled mathematically with an harmonic oscillator? And this is a sort of a kind of a, you know, difficult question to answer. Are there any relevant problems we look around that can be really described with an harmonic oscillator? I will give you more. So whenever we use the harmonic oscillator to describe a problem, for instance, we look at the oscillations of atoms in a chemical bond, we are making an approximation to model that kind of dynamics with an harmonic oscillator. So we are doing a physics assumptions anyway to begin with. Or later on in the second modulus of this course, we will develop the full quantum theory for the hydrogen atom. And, you know, we will put the same picture that we did for the classical theory. We will put a point like proton and an electron and a Coulomb force between the point like proton and the electron. And we will be able to solve the Schrödinger equation for this problem. Fantastic, this looks like it's an exact solution. Well, it's not, because anyway, we are neglecting relativistic effects that occur when a particle travels x to the speed of light. And in particular, they induce magnetic interactions which we neglect because we only include the Coulomb interaction, which is an electrostatic interaction. We neglect the structure of the nucleus, and so on and so forth. So physical modeling is intrinsically based on assumptions. Some assumptions in physical modeling concern the structure of the Hamiltonian. So basically, for instance, when you look at the particle in a confining potential, you can decide that, you know, you have a particle in a confining potential with a weird shape, you know, maybe this one, and you say, this is too difficult, let me model this with a particle in a box or with a particle in an harmonic oscillator. So in this case, your assumption sort of try to get you simpler Hamiltonians, which describe reasonably well the physical system you're interested in studying. And there are approximations or assumptions that concern the solution of a given Hamiltonian. So this is a dichotomy, this is a crossroad that anyone who's interested in physical modeling from a fundamental perspective will always be facing. Whether, you know, you will always be finding yourself in front of problems that cannot be exactly solved. Okay? And you will always have to make a choice whether you want to try to solve them by looking at slightly different problems, hopefully similar problems that you can solve. So touching the Hamiltonian and adapting standard exact solutions for that, or ideal solutions for that Hamiltonian. Or you want to keep that Hamiltonian and try both assumptions on the structure of the solution, as we shall see, or even both when the problem is particularly hard. And so whenever you move to the frontier of research, you begin walking on muddy grounds or thin ice, meaning that you don't walk on solid, well-established sort of mathematical or physical situations where you can sort of, you know, rely on each step that you're, you know, completely consistent with the theory you have in mind. But that's the life of a physicist and a chemist in general. And the big challenge of playing this role is being able to say something relevant while finding a path in this muddy water, muddy ground, or thin ice platform. So you have to find your way across this thin ice pond. To cross it, being able to say something while knowing that you'll never be able to solve the entire problem. Now, this was a long premise. Today, I will discuss two. So in this course, we will focus on two approximation methods. And let me begin with an ideal one. And in some sense, also the second will be ideal, but in practice will never be ideal. It will be very far from ideal. So I won't call it ideal. Well, it will become clear what I'm trying to say in a moment. But so basically, this method is called the expansion in a complete set. Or you can, you know, it's probably not its, you know, I don't know if it has a real name, but I'll call it this way. So suppose we have our, you know, our Schrodinger problem. We want to find a function and a corresponding set of states. A set of function, a set of states to solve the eigenvalue problem. Now, this is a formidable problem, as we know. However, let's suppose we know the spectrum, the set of eigenstates of some arbitrary, well, I can really, my script is very bad, arbitrary Hermitian operator. Oh, so in other words, suppose we can, technically you say you can diagonalize this operator, which means that we can find a complete set of states, which I will call maybe phi n, such that, you know, now, this is the problem I want to solve. And I say, I don't know these functions. But hey, I know the functions that are the eigenstates of another operator. Completely different. This I know. Example, I know the eigenstates of the momentum operator. They are the plane waves. Or I know the eigenstates of the position operator, and so forth. I can use this information, amazingly enough, given the properties of the mathematical formalism you're looking at, given the fact that I can solve this problem, I can use this to solve this problem. Looks like magic. But it's actually not magic. And as you shall see, is a generalization of the lattice discretization approach that I already discussed with you many times. So how on earth can the solution of the different problem help me find the solution of the problem that I'm interested in? Well, you see, the point here is the following. These guys here, this guy here is an Hermitian operator, right? So that means that this set of functions provide a complete orthonormal state space, right? They provide a complete orthonormal space. And why is this of any help? Well, the fact that they are complete orthonormal space means that any function n that I want to solve can be, in fact, expanded into a linear combination of these states. So once again, let me be very general. I want to find in general a solution of this equation. And what I do, I say the function x can be expanded as a linear combination with, in general, complex coefficients onto my basis, where this is the basis of my Hermitian operator. Now, since the Hilbert space has infinite dimensions, in general, this is an infinite dimensional sum. So this sum contains infinitely many terms because the space of functions we already discussed many times is basically a vector space with infinite dimensions. But in general, I might decide, you know, if I choose my functions carefully, and I will try to elaborate in a minute what I mean by carefully, but say with a judicious choice of the basis, it might be possible to use only a finite number of vector of basis element. Okay, so what does that mean? For instance, suppose we are interested, so to see what let me be quite practical and see what I mean with this idea of judicious choice. Suppose we want to solve like this problem here. This is a potential. And clearly this potential has a weird structure. And if I try to find exact analytic solution of the Schrödinger equation, I'm doomed to fail. I know the solution of a similar problem, the square wave problem. Right? So I'm looking for a solution C on N that are associated with the potential U, and I don't know them, but I know the basis vector psi on m, which are the solution of the potential square box. I mean, but maybe we are in a condition that I cannot simply say I identify these two, because you see, it is not always clear that, you know, here the potential is not always negligible. So I cannot simply say, that's my best guess for those. That's too simple. And this is the problem that I want to use in order to solve this problem. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna say, okay, this is the Schrödinger problem with the potential U. So I call it T plus U, this U here. And my Schrödinger equation is again. Now, suppose I'm interested in the first lowest excited states. So I know that the lowest static states will have a finite number of nodes, right? Remember, there's this famous relationship between the principal quantum number and the number of nodes in the wave function. And this is a property that is completely general. It does not concern only the infinite square well potential, it concerns any potential. There's a theorem that says, you know, the number of nodes in the wave function is given by the principal quantum number. So since this is our situation, I can say, if I'm interested in the first 6 or 7 eigenstates, I probably don't need the 125th eigenstate. So what I'm trying to say is that when I write a function as a linear combination with some coefficients of the eigenstates, which I write in this form, they will have nodes. But likely, since I'm interested in functions that don't have many nodes, the contribution to this sum from the very high excited states, which have a huge number of nodes, will be very small. So this is a physical sort of truncation, but I can always make it better by adding more and more states. So in some sense it is exact, because it is approximate only at finite number of states. But if I were to include all of them, then of course this will become exact. But I can use my physical intuition to say, okay, I will organize all these infinite states in such a way that I will use the ones that are lower number of nodes first, and I will stop when I think that I have enough to represent, say, the up to the sixth or seventh excited states of this Hamiltonian, whatever I want to. And if I want the 20th excited states, then I have at least 20 states here or more to be put into my expansion. Okay, so the whole idea is to truncate this expansion in some smart way to some finite number. Now, if I do that, let's look at my Hamiltonian. What I can do, my Hamiltonian is acting, so I can do this expansion at the level of a function. I was using the index n before. Or equivalently, I can do it at the level of the states, right? I find the latter a little bit more simple to handle, but you can go from one to another, for instance, projecting to position operator, and you get, you know, so if you project into position representation, you get this, the first line from the second line. Okay, now I have this problem, and this problem clearly becomes h sum over n from one to n of alpha n phi n, and I want, and this is be equal to e psi, which again is e sum over n alpha n phi n. Now I use linearity, and again I'm lecturing here, I'm using linearity, and I'm writing this expression, sum over one to n, n is now, remind you, finite, alpha n h acting on these states. Now, these are not eigenstates of this. So I don't know what this product is at the moment. Okay. And this is equal to sum over n. Well, if you want, en e times sum over n from one to n of alpha n phi of n. Now, next step is to take the inner product on both sides by another vector element. So basically what this is meaning is that I'm considering this mathematical object. So basically what I've done, this is a vector times, a matrix times vector multiplications, and which is again a vector, and I'm taking the inner product for another vector. So this is a number now. this is a number, this is a number. And this is now an equation for numbers. Here I'm in the vector space, here I'm in the numbers. So these are complex numbers in general. Okay, now remember the phi of n have been chosen to be eigenstates of the sum Hermitian operator, which means that they form a complete orthonormal set, which means that this is nothing but a Kronecker delta, delta n, m. So together, if I call this guy h, m, n, this matrix element h, m, n, I've come to the following result. Sum of n, h, m, n, alpha n equals to e alpha m. So basically, what I've obtained is an eigenvalue problem for alpha, where now this is a n by n matrix. And if I can find the eigenvalues e I going from one to n, and the corresponding coefficients ei, then I know the coefficients that are consistent with the Schrödinger equation, and therefore I know that I have a solution for the corresponding function. So let me call this the solution alpha bar, then the solution of the Schrödinger equation with this eigenvalue will be alpha I bar phi I of x. So by expanding into a complete orthonormal state and devising a suitable truncation, I've reduced the original problem, which I couldn't solve, to a simple problem that involves a matrix that I can diagonalize with any matrix. The only ingredient that is missing is this matrix element, right? So let's look at it a little bit better. What is it? This H of N is, if you go back in the notes and look at how to compute matrix elements, you can use, for instance, position representation and discover that this is nothing but m star of x, h acting on phi n of x, which if you want, you can represent it in one dimension here for simplicity, or in one part, so in three dimensions, doesn't matter. Okay, so in practice, how do you solve a problem? Well, basically, you choose a basis of a problem you can solve. You write your solution as a linear combination . This is the solution you goal. This is what you know. And of course, since you don't know the goal, you don't know the coefficients. So if you knew the coefficient, you knew the solution. So our goal is actually compute the coefficients. Unknown. And this is actually, if you want, our goal. And to do that, it can be seen here. So I need to move this up. And to do that, what do? You perform n by n integrals. Actually, you only need to perform the upper diagonal because the Hermitian matrix is Hermitian, the Hamiltonian, so you don't need to perform n square integrals. You only have to perform the ones in the upper triangular part. But anyway, you perform this integral numerically, because these are just integrals you can teach a computer to solve. And if you know you have a one-dimensional problem, this is something you can always do, one-dimensional integral numerically. And by doing this, you compute this matrix. And after you have computed the matrix, you diagonalize the problem. I call it alpha. I don't remember if I call it C or alpha, but never mind. You diagonal, you solve numerically this eigen problem. And this eigen problem will give you the energies and the coefficients. And once you have the coefficients, you know the corresponding expression for the wave function. So this is an exact method that allow you to get rigorous, arbitrarily accurate approximation, not only for the ground state, but for all the excited states of my system. Of course, the big pending question in this approach, which determine whether it's applicable or not, are two. First of all, I need to be able to compute quite efficiently these integrals, because this is something I need to do in order to get this matrix. And if these integrals are too complicated to be evaluable, then I got nothing in my hands, because I cannot do this game of relating this complicated differential eigenvalue problem to a linear algebra eigenvalue problem. But the second question that I'd like to say is, how do we know that we've chosen the right basis? How do we know that how do we improve on the approximation? And clearly, the two questions are related, because you know, if I truncate using 55 of elements of my basis, and I get the result, and then I begin adding new elements according to any procedure, maybe random, maybe according to some order, and I see that the result still changes significantly, the energies and the eigenvalues are changing, then clearly I didn't have enough. I didn't have enough terms in the expansion. So you can do that a posteriori by keeping adding coefficients and then looking back if, you know, if you add more, of course you have to evaluate many more integrals and diagonalize larger and larger matrices. Now, diagonalizing matrices today is not a big deal. There are very efficient algorithms that do that in a polynomial way, meaning that it's almost never a bottleneck, the operation of diagonalizing the matrix. What can be the bottleneck, is evaluating this integral if the problem is not just one-dimensional problem. Already in three dimensions, these integrals are quite, if you have a particle in three dimensions, this integral can be quite nasty. But if you have two particles, then your integral is six dimensional. And when you go to six dimensions, integrals in six dimensions, guys, are very hard. And then as soon as you get, you know, a few particles, then you're smashing against a wall that is in technical language called the curse of dimensionality. The complexity of the problem grows exponentially with the number of degrees of freedom. And very soon you reach a point that you cannot do this. So clearly here comes physical intuition into play, because you might say, if I find a smart basis, maybe I need just fewer terms in the sum. You know, let me give you an example. In principle, this method works with any basis. So for instance, say you have an harmonic oscillator, and although I didn't derive for you all the states of the harmonic oscillator, I told you we know all of them. So we know all the eigenstates for every single energy level of the harmonic oscillator. Now, suppose the problem that I want to solve is maybe this. Clearly, this problem is very different from the problems of an harmonic oscillator centered in the origin. So if I try to expand the ground state of this problem, which probably will look like something like this, using the basis of this eigenstate of this problem, of the U problem, the two problems are so different that I will need a lot of basis elements of this in order to find a good solution for this problem. Clearly, this choice of operator O being the harmonic oscillator center in the origin, let me call it choice O1, as the operator that provides me with the eigenstates on which I'm expanding, is not the best choice. However, if instead of this, I use a second problem, that is the harmonic oscillator center more or less in the same place, so I call it O2, and it's an harmonic oscillator center now in the point X1, then likely this detail of this little hump will not require, so all my function will be anyway focused in the right region. I will not have to consider the tails of the wave function, but the bulk of the wave function. So by taking as a basis the eigenstate of a Hamiltonian that looks like the problem that I want to solve, I in general will have to include fewer basis elements, keeping the problem as simple as it can possibly get. Right, so that's where the physico-chemical, in some cases, intuition comes. The physics, the human mind comes in and say, oh, for that problem, that's a very wrong choice of basis. My brain can immediately spot what would be a very good basis to solve the problem. Now we are in the middle of a statistical computing / artificial intelligence revolution. I prefer to call it statistical computing because many of the artificial intelligence algorithms were already available years ago, just the computer resources were not good enough, or some technical aspects such as back propagation for neural network was not available. But we are in the middle of the revolution of the industrialization of these methods. So a big challenge for the future is find ways to use artificial intelligence to learn about what is the best basis to use, making possible to solve problems that otherwise would become very, very, very hard to solve. So in the next lecture, what I will be doing will be to try to use these ideas that we sort of sketched here in a practical example. And we will consider a problem that concerns quantum tunneling in a one-dimensional problem system. So to see this theoretical framework in action, let's wait for the next lecture. Okay, I think I'll stop here.